Before our worship this morning, we will follow a service of prayer and preaching that begins on page 260 in your hymnal. This is the day which the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
From the rising of the sun to its setting,
the name of the Lord is to be praised.
Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere.
I would rather be a Lord here in the house of my God than in the tents of the wicked.
Make me to know your ways, O Lord.
Teach me your paths.
Sanctify us in your truth.
Your word is truth.
From the rising of the sun to its setting,
the name of the Lord is to be praised.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. For 2 months, we have been learning the Old Testament canticle. The choir would sing it once, and then we would sing it. That is what we are going to do with the New Testament canticle. I think we can try to work our way through the Old Testament canticle one time this morning. If you don't know it as well, maybe listen to the first verse and then come in on the refrain.
The Epistle of
comes from
the first epistle of John, chapter 1, beginning with verse 1. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands concerning the word of life, the life was made manifest, and we have seen it and testified to it and proclaimed to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us rise in honor of our Lord for the reading of the gospel. The gospel lesson appointed for this day comes from John chapter 20, beginning with verse 19. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of anyone, they are forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness from anyone, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Here ends the gospel lesson for this day. We continue with the response reading.
Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly set in the heavens.
Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells.
Blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it.
Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells.
Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit.
Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells.
At this time, I would invite the children to come forward for the children's message and congregation to receive.
And sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty.
From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Congregation, may be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for our message today is our first lesson, Acts 4, verses 32 to 35, also including verses 36 and 37, which read, "Thus Joseph, who was also called by the apostles Barnabas," which means son of encouragement, "a Levite, a native of Cyprus, sold the field that belonged to him and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet." This is our text. Dear friends in Christ Jesus, our text for today brings up the topic of nicknames. People get nicknames for a variety of reasons. Some just naturally seem to fit with their physical appearance or ability. Like calling someone Red, who has red hair. Or Lefty, because they're left-handed. Some nicknames are meant to be sarcastic. Like a guy I knew with the nickname Tiny, who was one of the biggest guys I had ever seen. A nickname can be shortened form of a longer first name, like Nat for Nathaniel, or Libby for Elizabeth. I've met a few guys who have the nickname Bud, yet I am not sure still where exactly that comes from. The same was true for people back in Bible times. For example, the disciple Simon was given another name, Peter, which means the rock. It was because of the solid confession he made when he said to Jesus, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." The disciples James and John at one time wanted to call down destruction on a town that didn't treat Jesus with respect. They were referred to as the Sons of Thunder. Traditionally, on the Sunday after Easter, we remember the nickname we've given to that disciple I brought up in the children's message, who didn't initially believe Jesus had risen from the dead. He's always been known as Doubting Thomas. Now, in our text from Acts chapter 4, we come across another nickname, Barnabas. The man's name is Joseph, but he's called Barnabas. Why? His nickname came as the result of what he so often did. He was an encourager. He built people up. He gave of himself to take care of others. He supported those who were in need. He was a son of encouragement. That's what Barnabas means. What a great nickname. Barnabas, the encourager. Now that's a nickname all of us should aspire to. All of us can be encouragers, just like Joseph from Cyprus. Think of it, a congregation of Barnabases. That's got a wonderful ring to it. So how did Joseph become Barnabas the encourager? Well, our text says, "And with great power the apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all." See, one of the points is the name Barnabas is a resurrection nickname. He becomes the encourager because of the power of Christ's resurrection. He encouraged people because the resurrection brought grace into his life. The resurrection of Jesus, however, is not only a name changer, it's a life changer. When Jesus rose from the dead, people's lives were changed. Consider this. On the night our Lord was arrested, Peter denies even knowing Jesus. He swore three times he never met him. He wasn't the rock that night. He was disgraced by his denial. But later, Jesus, alive and glorified, meets Peter on the beach and restores him. Changed by his meeting with the risen Lord, Peter becomes once again the solid rock of the early church, who tradition has it was martyred for his bold confession of the faith. Or Thomas, who was a doubter, but once he saw Jesus with his own eyes and touched him, his life too was changed by the resurrection, and he became a bold proclaimer of the gospel. We don't know if Barnabas ever personally saw Jesus risen from the dead. It doesn't really matter. The message of Easter was powerful and life-changing for Barnabas when he heard it. Jesus came to him through that gospel, and Joseph of Cyprus became Barnabas the encourager. The same is true for us. The message of Christ's resurrection changes us. Are you struggling with some sin in your life? Jesus is risen from the dead. Your life is changed because whatever that sin is, you are forgiven. Are you doubting God's love? Jesus is risen from the dead. Doubt becomes faith, strengthened once again, because his death was because he loves you. And the resurrection proves that he has a plan for your life. Are you too easily angered? Jesus is risen from the dead. Relax and be calm in his peace, because he lives to take care of whatever upsets you. Are you afraid of losing your health, your job, or someone you love? Jesus is risen from the dead. He is with you no matter what. Are you weak and burdened? Jesus is risen from the dead. He listens to the prayers that you take to him. Are you frightened at the prospect of your own death? Jesus is risen from the dead. You too will rise. Else will everyone who professes him, like Peter, like Thomas. Are you not the kind, positive, giving person that you know you should be? Jesus is risen from the dead. And he can change you into a Barnabas. Yes, you too can be a Barnabas. Just look at what he did. He had some property, a field. We don't know how big it was. We don't know how much he got for it. We don't know if he had other fields. None of that matters. What's important is that he did not consider that field as his own. No, he knew it was God's gift to him to use wisely. So he sold the field. And he brought the money to the apostles. What was the money used for? For those in need in the church. He saw that some people didn't have enough. He sold the field. He gave the money. You can guess what the result was. The people in need were encouraged. Someone cared for them. Someone knew what they were going through and wanted to help. Someone was willing to give away what he had to make sure they had enough. And you know who else was encouraged? Those in the church who watched Barnabas do this. They were encouraged that someone would be so generous. They saw that what they had wasn't their own either, but was the Lord's gift to them. And so they gave too. And in that church at that time, none of the members was in need. Barnabas, the encourager, changed by the resurrected Jesus, helped make that happen. Do you see then what the resurrection looks like? It's the grace and power of Jesus working in Joseph's life so that he'd get the resurrection nickname, the Son of Encouragement. And that's not the only time Barnabas was an encourager. Consider this. The Apostle Paul started many churches in many cities after Jesus rose from the dead. He wrote many of the books in the New Testament. But he was not always such a passionate proclaimer of the gospel. At one time, Paul, then known as Saul, persecuted the church until he was converted by the Lord on the road to Damascus. Paul met the risen Christ and was changed from persecutor to proclaimer. He wanted everyone to believe in Jesus, but not everyone believed in Paul. They didn't believe he had changed. Many were still afraid of him. And you know who helped pave the way for Paul to be accepted by the other disciples? Barnabas. He spoke up for Paul. He vouched for him, traveled with him. He put his life and reputation on the line for Paul. His words encouraged Paul. That encouragement could have been one of the reasons that Paul became the greatest missionary and church starter the Christian church has ever seen. Behind it was Barnabas, the encourager. Or later on, when Paul and Barnabas were on a mission trip, they took a young man by the name of John Mark with them. Now, these mission trips could be difficult, and at one point, John Mark became homesick and deserted the team to go home. At a later date, after John Mark had matured a bit and realized that he had left Paul and Barnabas down, he wanted to help them on another mission trip. Paul refused, but Barnabas wanted to give the young man another chance. So Paul went on the trip with Silas, and Barnabas went with John Mark on another trip. John Mark, who eventually became a leader in the early church. Again, Barnabas, the encourager. Here we are today. We've heard the powerful message of God's grace. Jesus is risen from the dead. He is at work in our lives. He is changing us. We can be modern day Barnabases. What does that look like today? Well, Barnabas spoke up to Paul and John Mark. The words he used were words of encouragement. What words of encouragement can you use to build up someone today? Look around you with a discerning eye. Look for the value in the people around you. Think of the unique gifts that they are to our church, to our family of faith here at Trinity. Recognize what other people may not see, and be the one to let them know how much you appreciate them. It may seem like such a small and insignificant thing, but your words may encourage a life that then goes on to encourage others. It becomes like a pebble thrown into a pond, causing waves that ripple out farther and farther. So one way to be an encourager is to use words that are a gift to someone else, to build people up, to let them know that someone cares, to let them see that Jesus cares through you. Barnabas also gave to those in need. That still happens in the church today. I'm struck by the fact, you know, at Christmas time, we have such a tremendous response to our food drive and our giving tree to provide gifts for those less fortunate. What a wonderful encouragement. But need exists all throughout the year. As nice as it is to have Barnabases at Christmas, they are really needed throughout the year. Support the Auburn Food Bank, the clothing bank being run out of Grace Lutheran, or check out contributing to the food co-op and clothing co-op at Concordia Theological Seminary in Fort Wayne, the bulletin item on the back of the bulletin today. This is part of what Jesus meant when he once said, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." It means to give of ourselves so that we might encourage others. Joseph of Cyprus was given a resurrection nickname, Barnabas, the son of encouragement. It's a good nickname for us too, when we encourage others with words that build up and by the generosity we show. But let's remember one more nickname today. It's one for Jesus, who, of course, had many nicknames. Savior, Good Shepherd, Redeemer, Lord, Prince of Peace. The list could go on and on. But today we've heard another name for Jesus. Life changer. The risen Christ changed the lives of Peter, of Thomas, of Paul, of Joseph of Cyprus, to name just a few. Jesus' resurrection gives grace and power to change lives into Barnabases for our world today. Encourages with words and generosity. Jesus is risen from the dead. Jesus is the life changer. Amen. We rise. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us remain standing as we sing our next hymn, hymn 480.
Thank you.
response of prayer, as it is printed in your hymnal, we do have a couple of special prayers this day. A prayer of thanksgiving to God for Gary and Laurel Weiss, who are today celebrating their 40th wedding anniversary. We also ask God's hand of healing would rest upon Betty Leis, who had a procedure done last week, Calvin Walter and Shirley Walter, who are both continuing their chemotherapy, and Dale Cloa, the brother of Lyle and Ken, who is undergoing some health struggles. We continue with the responsive prayer. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the gift of divine peace and of pardon, with all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord. For the Holy Christian Church here and scattered throughout the world, and for the proclamation of the gospel and the calling of all to faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this nation, for our cities and communities, for the common welfare of us all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For seasonable weather and for the fruitfulness of the earth, let us pray to the Lord. For those who labor, for those whose work is difficult or dangerous, and for all who travel, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in need, for the hungry and homeless, for the widowed and orphan, for all those in prison, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the sick and dying, for all those who care for them, let us pray to the Lord. Father of all mercies, you have established the estate of marriage as a blessing for us. We give thanks along with Terry and Laurel, who celebrate 40 years of married life together. Continue to enrich this couple with an ever greater outpouring of your love and commitment. Bless them and their family, and grant that their life may continually witness to the truth of your word, that what you join together, man should never break apart. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord of life, we ask you to bless all of our members and loved ones who are suffering physical needs at this time. Especially do we ask that your hand of healing and recovery would rest upon Betty, Calvin, Shirley, and Dale. Strengthen these, your servants, in their bodies, and increase their faith in your loving care. Grant healing according to your gracious will for their lives. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Finally, for these and for all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, grant that we who have celebrated the Lord's resurrection may, by your grace, confess in our life and conversation that Jesus is Lord and God. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Blessed Lord, you have caused all the scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We pray together. I thank you, my Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. And I pray that you would keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings and life may please you. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. We have not, to this point, learned the New Testament canticle, because we introduced this service during the Lenten season where that is omitted. However, we are now in the Easter season, and so we will learn the New Testament canticle. There are choir members here who will go through it once, And then the second time we will join in.
Thank you. house this day, and I invite you to shake the hands of the people around you and share God's blessing. Somebody was asking before, well, when should we start contributing towards our pledge? The answer is yes. Go right ahead. And if you don't know what your pledge was, the only person who knows what your pledges are is you and Royce Wedman. So we're going to try to figure out a way, maybe two people like, oh, I forgot, block a sheet or something, that he can fill out and then send back to you so it's all kept confidential. Not everybody knows what everybody's pledged or what everybody's giving. That's between you and God, actually. Not that I'm referring to Royce as God, but I do. So, you can start your contributions. But if we're going to do that, then we need to hire. We're going to split some of 5 and 6 next year. So we're going to have a discussion about that tomorrow night, 7 o'clock, over in school. Other things happening in the week. Things are going to be kind of, from the end of April and May until we get to summer. Lots of things going on. So keep an eye on the calendar and the bulletin. And may the Lord, who has risen from the dead and filled us with his grace and his power, make of us each to be a little Barnabas in our life, and an